Thank you, Dr. Kumanyika. Now we are going to begin with questions and answers. And I think we may actually be starting with some of our 6,000-plus folks out there. Dr. Cote.
Good morning. The first question we have, someone would like to, for Dr. Cote, for you to elaborate, how does Healthy People 2020 address health equity?
Sure. So that's one of the four overarching goals for Healthy People 2020. And the goal, of course, is to have each person really have an opportunity to reach their highest attainable standard of health. And so the theme of health equity is woven through every topic area, every objective that we are presenting today. If you go on the new wonderful website, there is an interactive place where you can look at the disparities data of your own particular interest. You can pick a reference racial ethnic group or a certain baseline age group and literally create your own graphs and data and look at the disparities of special interest to you and your communities. And then throughout all the topic areas, there is attention to reducing those disparities by race, by ethnicity, by age, by disability status, by sexual orientation. So this is really a very important overarching goal and overarching theme for Healthy People 2020. I don't know if one of my colleagues wanted to say more about that.
Okay, now to the audience.
Good afternoon. My name's Lisa Pratt. I'm really excited about the technology innovations that you discussed, and I'm really looking forward to what comes out of your My Healthy People Challenge. My concern, however, is the potential for creating a new type of disparity between those who have access to technology and those who don't, which would probably also fall along the lines of those who are low income, primarily minority, and already the ones that are probably struggling the most to achieve good health. Do you have some kind of innovations that are going on to address and to reach those people that don't have access to technology?
It's a fantastic question, and I might divide my answer into two parts. So specifically with the My Healthy People App Development Challenge, that's really to build apps that are for public health professionals, local health leaders, community activists, et cetera, who can then use those dashboards, use that information about benchmarks and interventions to then take action in their community to help address disparities. But specifically with respect to the application of technology to help cross the divide, and help bridge the disparities directly. One great example is Text for Baby. I don't know if you've heard about Text for Baby, but this fantastic public-private partnership that's come together to deploy a free a text message service where any mother can text baby or bebé in Espanol to 511-401 and get automatically enrolled in a whole series of messages about how to take care of yourself and your baby in the first year of the baby's life during pregnancy and after after delivery. All the wireless companies in the country have agreed to provide the messages for free. The content's been crafted by a great public-private team. And it's actually just recently crossed 100,000 moms enrolled in it. And the mothers are actually disproportionately in areas that are underserved and low income. Because while access to the web is, you know, say X, right? Access to text messages is Y. And so it's a fantastic potential way to help bridge the divide. In fact, a lot of the coolest applications of text messaging have not been happening in America, but in the developing world, where in fact the ubiquity of text messaging among broad populations has been a wonderful vehicle through which to help get information out there, help get care to the right people. And so that's just one example. And there are many others actually brewing as well. But that's just one example of how technology can potentially help bridge the divide.
Thank you. We have another online question. How can faith-based communities be involved in this initiative?
Well, I can certainly start. Faith-based organizations are a tremendous example of the social determinants approach at work, where people worship and pray is often a place where people also have the strongest social networks and often receive also information that can be of value to the health of their families and their neighborhoods. So in fact, in our department, we have a faith-based office that's very involved in outreach. I'll give you a tremendous example on flu vaccination outreach for this season. And having faith-based partners work through that channel has been a tremendous benefit for public health. So we view that partnership as a very valuable one moving forward.
Dr. Koh, I'm Scout from the Network for LGBT Health Equity.
I know you.
Exactly. And I just want to say, on behalf of all the LGBT people out there, especially particularly the transgender populations, which have experienced such significant health disparities that have so long gone unrecognized and are frankly just a life or death issue for many people, thank you so much for including this as a topic area. That is really to be rewarded. And my question would be, since we see federal monies come out that do not also include prioritization or just even routine inclusion of these populations, is what kind of changes can we then see as RFAs come out, things like that? Like when CPPW RFA came out, LGBT people weren't mentioned at all, and as a result didn't get much of that targeted cash. So what can we see as far as the changes with this historic change here?
Thank you for raising that issue. And Scout, thank you for your passion. You've become a good friend in recent months, and we really enjoy your leadership. So I think multiple ways to answer your question. One is that we need to collect better data, and that's a huge focus for the new LGBT topic area work group. We have a section of the Affordable Care Act, section 4302, I even memorized the number, where we're doing public hearings to see if we can get some consensus about gaining specific data on LGBT populations in federally sponsored surveys. And then we also want to make sure that the definition of disparities is a broad definition. It's beyond race and ethnicity. It also includes disability status and income level and geography and sexual orientation and other dimensions. So there's a tremendous commitment on this issue, if I can say, led by the secretary in our department. We have a coordinating committee that's been formed that's meeting regularly to try to advance issues. There's leadership from the president on hospital visitation rights. So there are many, many dimensions where I think we're making forward progress.
Hello. My name is Stephen Thomas. I'm a professor in the School of Public Health at the University of Maryland in College Park. And many of the schools of public health and medicine and academic health centers are clearly part of the all hands on deck. But if you were to draw a 1 mile radius around many of our most prestigious institutions, you would find that they actually live in the hotspot of great inequality. What obligation, moral or otherwise, do this part of the team have to ensure that our academic institutions take this commitment and address the role that they may be playing in structural determinants of health leading to inequality?
Thank you, Dr. Thomas. I remember meeting you in the past as well, and I thank your leadership. I think I'm going to call on my academic colleague, Dr. Kumanyika, to respond to that one. I'm not in academia anymore.
All right. Thanks for that question. I think that, and we may hear more about that in the panel discussion that follows, there's a lot of interest in linking Healthy People 2020 to curricula in schools of public health, which I think would be, and programs in public health, which could be in the lead in showing how Healthy People 2020 can be implemented around universities and in the community. I don't think that the academic engagement with Healthy People has been what it could be. We hope that we have some of the products we've created that are on the website. We have a paper on the use of evidence in public health. There's a paper on the social determinants and some other specific documents that show what we have talked about. We've expanded the definition of health disparities to try to focus on social disadvantage. So all the elements are there. And if we could get every program in public health, for example, to adopt a part of Healthy People and make a commitment that when students do projects and what they learn is linked to goals so that it's purposeful, it's not just picking your favorite topic, but it's looking, you know, where can we have an impact and where can we change things. So I think this is a mandate for public health education.
Thank you. I think there's a great opportunity for universities. I think we in public health may have a tendency sometimes to be too health-centric, but I don't think we are any more so and probably less so than most universities when we talk to people in the health part of that university. Universities, many of them have schools of agriculture. They have people expert in planning and public policy. They have people, they have education schools and the like. And if we're really going to have health in all policies and get all the best and the brightest thinking about it, then universities, particularly these large research universities, need to, in fact, bring together all the parts of their own school and get the synergy from that. If you want to try and figure out what's the impact on health of a change in educational attainment, for example, you need to be doing health impact assessment with people who have expertise in how you look at educational literature, not just public health literature. So I think there are opportunities. The opportunities really abound even more broadly than in schools of public health or in the medical public health parts of universities.